clustered, regularly interspaced, short, palindromic repeats, otherwise known as CRISPR. So, what is it? CRISPR is a cutting-edge technology that can be used to edit genomes. It's like a molecular pair of scissors that can find, cut, and change specific parts of a genetic makeup. There are plenty of applications of CRISPR, from curing diseases to making designer babies. CRISPR also has a prominent place in the world of biological art. These days, humans and technology are coming together like never before. From the lab to your own home, CRISPR is opening the door to a lot of possibilities. But with all of these promises, there are just as many concerns, which is why we must proceed with caution.
Hi, I'm Adam Zaretsky. I'm sort of a bioartist. I'm a literati. I'm a demented fool. I do bioart. I'm into, living philosophy. And I'm also just into comedy and the obscure. Okay, so mutafelch was one of a few different explorations into do-it-yourself methods of transgenesis.
Transgenesis is the process of introducing a gene from one organism into the genome of another organism. A transgenic organism is one that has been altered through recombinant DNA technology or genetic modification. The intent is for the modified organism to display some new property or a characteristic.
The idea was to make a new biologically artistic media for painting or printmaking or experimenting with, for body paint, for finger paint, et cetera. But there's lots of rituals about blood, shit, sperm, and milk. I wanted to mix them together with nanoparticles of gold soaked in DNA and try to make transgenic sperm, shit, and blood. It's sort of process-based art. It's sort of conceptual. It's sort of heavily actual, like bioart is really, it can be conceptual art, but it needs that actuality beyond the artifact that most art doesn't have. The paintings themselves, well, there's no other paintings with this media, right? It's a new media. It's time-based. It's semi-alive. It's a, what art is supposed to be? Priceless.
I actually went to the ninth floor and I was going to work my way down and I said, has anybody got some artistic plasmids?
CRISPR was stolen from bacteria. Bacteria use it as an immune system. It's really good at basically doing scullery on invaders.
This kind of bacterial immune system against the viral intruders. You can basically design those 20 base pairs to be such that you exactly match the piece that you want to cut in the DNA. A bit like word search.
So I guess CRISPR is a drag queen and CRISPR is a drone attack. CRISPR, we use bacterial immune systems. We put on nature as a drag costume and we walk around as nature. When drones attack, they don't just hit their target. They do a lot of collateral damage. CRISPR is just as haphazard and there's always going to be some collateral damage. And so as far as safety, I don't think it's there. As far as, are you allowed to do it? You're probably allowed to do anything, you know?
So I am Roland von Dierendonck. I'm an artist, formerly biologist, currently living in Oslo in Norway, and also just started on a PhD at Sheffield Hallam University. Yeah, so Return to Dillman is a project by Günter Seyfried, Federico Mafato, Hans-Jörg Petschko, and myself. Basically, we took an image, encoded the pixels into DNA code. So every color was a certain combination of base pairs, T, C, G, and A. And that was ordered to be synthesized by a company, and we got it in the lab. And in the lab, we using CRISPR-Cas9, we cut out a specific part and we pasted another part in, and then we set it off again to sequence. And so we got a new code back, and that was translated into an image again. So it was kind of a really how do you say it in English? Like difficult, long way of doing kind of Photoshop in the laboratory. And in our case, we used an image of a bull's head with the closed eyes, and in the end, the eyes were supposed to open, which they did with some other colorful pixels popping up because of mutations and other sequencing errors. But it did succeed in the end. And it's called Return to Dilmun because Dilmun, because the bull's head image comes from Dilmun. It's also an interesting area because it's also linked to stories of the Garden of Eden, which supposedly also in this might be linked to this Dilmun area.
This is a place of culture, tradition, and a history going back into the mists of time. This was Dilmun.
And all these stories also have to do with kind of the question or whether or not we want to be immortal or have all the knowledge and fail in that. So there's this kind of this link also between kind of the possibilities of CRISPR and kind of the mythological and the storytelling layers of the project. I think it's very important for people to form opinions on kind of matters that have a huge impact to the times we live in. In the case of CRISPR, also the questions were, do we want to make like CRISPR babies? Like it can be used to eradicate diseases, but potentially also to kind of create like funky mutant humans. Do we want it?
We have to have a range of humans. For one, for biodiversity's sake, and for another, because otherwise we're going to end up with monocultures based on engineering values, and we're going to be in this horrible, horrible, like Candy and Mandy met Biff and Danny kind of Barbie world. But that's like how our kids are going to end up, is somewhere between I dreamed of a child on ketamine that was part alien and like this sort of super realism, hyper normalization of manhood and womanhood, you know, like this nightmare of being stuck in someone's dream of perfection.
For want of a better estimate, let's call it the year 2000. At any rate, imagine a time in the future when science has developed the means of giving everyone the face and body he dreams of. It may not happen tomorrow, but it happens now in the Twilight Zone.
You know, your parents will be like, sorry, you were like the 2072 model, you know, perfection kid.
Mother, Val, look at me. What do you think?
You're beautiful, Marilyn, just beautiful.
And the nicest part of all, Val, I look just like you.
Portrait of a young lady in love with herself. Improbable? Perhaps. But in an age of plastic surgery, bodybuilding, and an infinity of cosmetics, let us hesitate to say impossible. These and other strange blessings may be waiting in the future, which, after all, is the Twilight Zone.
Yeah, it's all bad taste because now it's 2083 and you're only 10 and you're already passé. And the aesthetics sucked because they were like, they only had enough money for like, you know, a Ken and a Barbie. And they bought them both and they were like, sorry. Because right now we're going to try to make Superman. It's the stupidest, like most boring thing, like super persons. It's not Marvel. It's like the full-on range of biodiversity, like human jellyfish, you know, humans with kangaroo pouches, humans that are 700 meters tall, you know, humans that give birth through their tear ducts, you know, little babies come out when you cry. And so you're like, tell me something sad. Oh, and then 1,000 babies come out, you know.
I don't know. It's important to picture, to kind of envision these futures, but you have to be able to have some kind of basic knowledge to follow these discussions, just like with internet security discussions. It's kind of similar, like you need like a basic vocabulary and a basic understanding of the issues at stake to be able to contribute to these discussions. I think it's both a kind of a constructive discussion about these topics, but it's also kind of to counteract, I think that's very important, to counteract illegitimate fears. There's so much kind of negative publicity against genetically modified organisms that is hardly marketed at all.
A lot of my labs are hands-on, and a lot of them are in public, like not even, you know, in an institution, they're outside. And we're just practicing maybe, you know, to make the tree supposedly make more money, right? But we don't know the long-term effect of what we do. I'm with you, just in case you couldn't tell. So you run into these problems of ethical, bioethical oversight. Someone has to assess whether or not it's allowed to be exhibited if it is transgenic. Someone has to decide whether or not it can be released, or how close people can get to a transgenic organism on display. Are they allowed to touch it? Are they allowed to lick it? Are they allowed to, you know, spend the night with a transgenic chicken? You know, do you want to spend a night with a transgenic chicken? You need paperwork. So depending on how you're working with life, and depending on your own ethics too, you run into various different scenarios. I guess because there are rules, but there's also different ways of seeing things. Rhetorically, things are debatable as far as bioethics goes.
I worked a while at Laag in Amsterdam. At Laag is an institute for opening up kind of for art, technology, and society, and for opening up discussions about new technologies like the internet or like biotechnologies like CRISPR. And we did this workshop using the do-it-yourself CRISPR kit sold by the Odin, where you introduce this gene into a yeast that becomes, I'm looking for a word, resistant. One point, there's a point in a protocol where you actually do a heat shock. This is the moment of actually genetically introducing new materials. And at this moment, because we were not allowed to make GMOs at the lab, we had this huge discussion of are we gonna do it? Are we not gonna do it? Like, who wants to vote in favor of it? Who is against it? And we kind of framed this very specific discussion more in kind of the general discussion as well. Like, where is this CRISPR technology going? Where do we want to go with this as society? And kind of the need that everybody has to, well, not everybody, like the need that more people have to have an image of what it is and what it can do in the future. And,
ik ben wel benieuwd hoe ze die plasmide en zo, of die laten bestellen ze ook weer ergens, geloof ik.
Misschien moet je nog even vertellen dat bij de eerste keer hadden jullie een biosafety officer, toch? Hoe werkt dat?
Een biosafety officer. Ja.
Wat is dat?
Ja, is bioveiligheidsofficier.
Nou, helder, dankjewel. Ja. Ga verder.
Ja. I like to look at the nuances. And in particular, when I run into bioethics and rule-based stuff, I go to these conferences like the Human Genome Editing Initiative, and I see everybody's sort of like got their, they're kind of having like a fake soiree of competition about like who says what and which is going and da-da-da. There's the Union of Concerned Scientists saying like, this is all bullshit, it kills children, it causes cancer, and they're right. And then there's people saying like, it's better than ever. You know, and then there's people in the middle, it's better than ever, but it causes, you know, cancer. Or it's better than ever and it causes cancer and we should go ahead with the experiment because it's going to get better and it won't get better if we don't try. And at the same time, when I was I went to the Human Genome Editing Initiative and heard all these arguments, and then you turn around and there's some transgenic twins popping out, and you know, like Dr. He from China is just like, I did it. I'll go to jail for 3 years and then you can give me the Nobel Prize. And he's right. I'm thinking of going to visit him in jail. I really think he did a number, but I don't think he knows it. He's a bioartist. Like, he made transgenic children based on an aesthetic.
Chinese scientist, hey, introducing the CRISPR babies to the world. Because before that, there were like these hypothetical discussions of what if there would be like human modification, then he just did it. I mean, that's a very questionable research, because who knows how the babies are doing now and like who's monitoring that, and kind of, was it worth to modify this gene related to HIV or intelligence that we currently, I'm most worried, I think, with CRISPR, that it could in some ways it could be very unequally distributed. If it's going to be like a very expensive thing that you can do like as an extra to modify your children to have a Gucci logo or whatever Adam Zaretsky all dreamed up in his things. Yeah, in a way it's cool, but on the other hand, it's also maybe going to create an even bigger inequality in society. But apart from that, I think that a lot of funky things can be done with biotechnology, and also like on the level of bacteria or mushrooms or plants, or, and I expect like a lot of these things that are now dreamed up to be actually realized in the next like 10 years.
I'm working on a library of human gene edits that represent alternative aesthetics for the future of human engineering. You know, but they're not going to say we can add in antelopeness. And there is no more beautiful animal to mix with the human genome than antelope. We would be so much more elegant. You see this? This is nice, but with a little antelope, honey. You know what I mean? So I'm just like, I'm looking into options just in case no one is offering options, at the very least plaid. Right? A plaid person. Just like, I want some punk kids out there. If we're going to punk our kids, let's punk them good. Right? Does that make sense?
I think the most important thing is kind of what we discussed earlier, like what is CRISPR and how does it work, and kind of understanding that it is this kind of molecular tool that can be used to cut DNA, and because of that, to introduce new genes.
Unfortunately, I think it's pretty much ensured that a form of germ warfare will be used to make sure that we have to have engineered babies. I'm not so much fighting against it, even though I think it's really bad for the human genome. Like, I think in the long run, it just weakens us as a species. I don't think it's a survival tool. I think it's a gee-gaw. It's like an emoji. Yeah, you can have an emoji kid. It's kind of trending. It's memic, but it doesn't, you know, it's a memic cataclysm. I think it's just important to make people realize that we are not our genes, that gene fetishism has its limits, and it's really much closer than you think. You know, like, someone only needs to give you a glass of milk and slap you with a wet towel and then tickle you, and you're completely different.
It would be sad if it would be only like associated with, like, for example, CRISPR babies or whatever implementation that's used CRISPR, because it's used for such a wide array of things. That I think it's just, the most important thing is to know, like, that is a tool that biotechnology is used to cut DNA and genetically mix and match things, although there's so much we don't know yet and so much to uncover.
There's so much of the unknown that's left unexplored because it's perceived of as being, you know, not of worth. And that's something that we're all trying to overcome, right? In multiple other areas, but this is an interesting one, and it may have a great influence, right? Like, so let's remember that we are already alternative just by having I don't know what we were, but we're this now. This is a shout out to Dr. Dierendonck, because I kind of warmed the Vogue Society up for the wet lab that he's working at. We worked on eco-art labs, we worked on food labs, we worked on bio-art labs, we worked on tissue culture labs, we did stuff with non-human art, we did stuff with body art. We had lots of hands-on public labs and lectures, and I brought in all kinds of artists, and I did a really good job of sort of building the Vogue up where they had enough clout to get a wet lab going. And so I wanted to say hey to Lucas and Roland, and sort of like, you're welcome. I got a PhD out of it, and I'm still publishing from the stuff I did there. It was really fun and really enlightening. Some people miss me there. I know that things have not been quite as fun and rowdy since I've left, but I wouldn't mind. I'll see you guys. We'll see you in Amsterdam sometime. Bye, Roland. Hello.